Hello and welcome to another episode in the Godot Basics Tutorial Series. In this episode, we will be taking a look at saving and loading from a file. First, we must learn what persistent data is. Now, persistent data is data that doesn't change over time and change in memory. Most games have the intention of saving game state, for example, your player stats, perhaps player score, and even levels unlocked. Now, there are two different types of persistent data. We have local storage, which is just basically saving to a physical device such as a computer or tablet. And we have cloud storage, which is just basically saving to a server. In this episode, we will be looking at local storage. We will not be touching on cloud storage. Now, when saving and loading data from a file, there's usually four steps, and these four steps are common no matter what programming language you use, whether it's GDScript, C++, or even Java. You will adhere to basically four steps. The first step is you need to open a file. The second step is that you need to open up a file stream. And file streams generally come in different types, and we will look at that later. After you've opened up the file and you've opened up a file stream, you are going to read and or write to your file. And what you are able to do is dependent on the type of file stream you have opened. And then once you are done, you're going to go ahead and you're going to close your file. Again, these are four basic steps, no matter the programming language. Now, there are different stream types. The first type is an input stream. Now, you use an input stream when you want to read from a file. The second type of stream is an output stream, and you use an output stream when you want to write and or create a file. And lastly, you do have an input-output stream, which just allows you to read, write, and or create a file. Now, the stream we choose determines how we are able to manipulate the file. For example, if we open up an input stream, we are not able to write to the file. And if we create an output stream, we are not able to read from a file. Again, this is all dependent on the programming language, and Godot has something similar. Before we can write or read to a file, we need to create an instance class object of the file class. The file class inherits from reference, and the file class handles the reading and writing of files. Let's go ahead and take a look at how to write to a file in Godot. This is pseudocode. So first we need to create an instance object of the file class, so file.new method, and over here we have a variable called save file, and that is our file class variable. From our file class variable, we use the open method, and the open method takes in two arguments. The first argument is a file path in a string format. The second argument will take in an enum value that represents what type of file stream we want. And because we're saving a file, we want to write to a file. And so in one line of code, we've already completed steps 1 and 2. After that, we would like to manipulate our data, basically step 3. And so in this case, we're going to use the store line method because we want to store our values line by line. And then when we are done, we're going to close our file. Keep in mind that when we use the file stream write, we are going to replace an existing file if it already exists, and we're going to create a new file if it does not exist. Let's go ahead and see how to read from a file. What we want to do is, again, create a file class instance object using the new method, so file.new. From our class instanced variable, we want to use the open method. The first argument needs to be a string value that represents the path to the file, followed by a comma, followed by the read stream type. And so again, in one line of code, we're able to complete steps 1 through 2, open a file, declare a stream type, and then we can manipulate our file. And so in this case, because we're loading, we just want to read, and we're going to use the getAsText method. In this case, because it's pseudocode, we aren't really doing anything. We're just converting the entire file into a string value. And then lastly, we're going to close our file. Now, in Godot, there is a way you should be saving your files. And first, it's line by line. What I mean by that is you have a variable you want to save. Your variable should be a dictionary. You take that dictionary and you convert it into a JavaScript object notation file, also known as a JSON file. And then from there, you can use the StoreLine method. Now, how should files be saved? Well, let's take a look at pseudocode. We're using the for keyword, which just means we're going to loop. In this case, we have saved data in an array. Now, again, don't write your variables like this. This is just pseudocode, and I'm just letting you know that we are looping an array. And over here, we have our already created file class instance object save file. And we're going to use the StoreLine method. And over here, we're going to use the toJSON method provided to us by the Godot application. And what it does is it takes in a dictionary value. So our saved data is a dictionary value, and it will convert our dictionary value into a JSON file format. And that JSON file format, we are going to save line by line in our file. Now, how should files be read? Well, files should be read line by line. As a matter of fact, saving and reading line by line is common in many programming languages. In Godot, we will be reading line by line, and we will convert every single line into a dictionary value that will be stored in a variable. And so again, we take JSON object, we convert it to dictionary variable. And this is pseudocode again, but imagine we have our instance file class object called data file. Well, we're going to use get position, which is at what position in the file are we at. We start at 0, which is the first line in our file. And then as long as we are less than the length, we're going to get our file, or rather get the line, so datafile.getLine, and we're going to use the parseJSON method. And that's going to convert our JSON file format into a dictionary value that we can pass into a variable. So that would mean that our node data is in fact a dictionary. Now, one quick thing to mention is path strings. So far in the Godot series, we've only touched on resource paths, and we use the RES keyword. Now, the problem with this is that when a game is exported to a device, the files become read-only. That means we cannot write to it. And so you may have no issues whatsoever if you were to use the resource path string file when reading and writing, in quotations, persistent data. But once you export that into a game, into a device, you will no longer be able to write to it, and so writing becomes useless. You are unable to save. To get around with this issue, you need to use user path strings. User path strings are similar to resource path strings in that instead of the RES keyword, we use the user keyword. And that will allow us to write our files onto the device, or rather somewhere on the device's operating system in a folder most likely unreachable by the average user. Now, if you want to debug what you're writing to a file, keep in mind that the file paths in development is not the same as the file paths for production. So, if you're using macOS like myself, your files will be saved in development under the following. It will be under your user folder, followed by the library folder, followed by the application support folder, followed by the Godot folder, followed by app_user data, followed by the project name of your Godot project, and then saved in that folder will be a list of files that you have saved. For Windows, it will be similar using the Windows file path, and for Linux, it will be similar as well using the Linux file path. Let's go ahead and take a quick look at some code. So over here, we have our GDScript file. Nothing special about it. It's just a simple reading and writing to a file, but it will illustrate the point of what we need to do in order to read and write. Now, first, you do need a dictionary. And so in this case, we have our saved data dictionary variable, which just has two information, player name, which is Jon Snow, and location, which is the North. Now, we do need a path string. And so over here, we have a variable name to hold that. The variable name is save game file name. It's a string data type, and we're using the user keyword. And we're going to save it to a playerData.txt file. I have the ready virtual method, and all it does is it's going to print to the screen the original data. So Jon Snow, location the North. We're going to load a data, and then we're going to display on the console the newly created data. Now the data we're going to show, if we saved correctly, is that our player name is going to be called Godot and our location is going to be called Tron City. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the save data method, because that's how we're going to save our file. So the save data doesn't do anything. It doesn't return a value. However, we're going to the edit data method, which just changes our dictionary value. And then we're going to go ahead and we're going to create a file class instance object called save file. Save file, we're going to use the open method. We're going to insert our user path followed by an enum that represents the file stream we want. In this case, because we're saving a data we would like to write. And then lastly, we're going to save line by line using the store underscore line method provided to us by the file class. We're going to convert our dictionary into a JSON object using the to underscore JSON method. And then it takes in an argument, which should be a dictionary. And then lastly, we're going to close our file. Now in this case, the save data method will go ahead and create a file if it doesn't exist. And if a file does exist, we're going to write over it. So keep that in mind. Now, when exactly do we call the save data method? Well, a few places we should call the save data method is when we pause our game and when we quit our game. Now, we haven't talked about notifications yet, but in this case, we're going to save our file when we quit our game. So as you can see here, when our game quits, we're going to call our notification, and then when we notice that our game is ready to quit, we're going to call the save data method. We're going to save our new file in our local storage system, and then we're going to go ahead and quit the game. Now let's go ahead and take a look at that right now. Now when we open our game, it does nothing. However, we can see towards the console log that our original data is player name Jon Snow and location the north, and our outer data is Jon Snow followed by the north again, because we didn't save our data and we didn't load data from a file. Remember, our file does not exist at this point in time. And so we close, and just keep in mind that now our save file should have player name as Godot and location as Tron City. So let me go ahead and open that file. So as you can see here in our file, we have location, Tron City, player name Godot. One thing to keep in mind is that your dictionary, when you transform it into a JSON file, your JSON file will in fact reorganize the order of your data in alphabetical order. So notice how our saved data, it was player name first, then location. However, when we saved the data, our location is first because alphabetically L comes before the letter P. So just something to keep in mind. It should not matter when dealing with dictionaries. Okay, so good. Now we see that our location and player name values have changed. They are no longer Jon Snow and the North. They are Godot and Tron City. Now let's go ahead and take a look at how we load data. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that loading data is tricky. And the reason for that is if our file doesn't exist and we try to load our file, we are going to throw an error. On top of that, even if our file does exist, when we try to load data from a file that is not there, we will throw an error. And we'll take a look at that as we go through the code. Now, again, our function loadData will do exactly as the name implies. We are going to load the dictionary JSON formatted file from the text file into our dictionary variable, which again is called save data. So first we need to create an instance object of the file class, and the instance object variable is called data file. Now first we need to make sure that our file actually exists on the system. Now to make sure if our file does in fact exist, we're just going to use a simple if statement. If not, keep in mind that the not keyword inverts our Boolean value. So again, if not, data file dot file exists, and we have to pass it in the user path file, which again is inside our save game file name variable. And so in this case, if our file doesn't exist, we are going to exit our function and do absolutely nothing. That way we don't crash if our file doesn't exist. However, if our file exists, we're going to continue on. And so since our file exists, we're going to open that file. We're going to use the user file path followed by the read enum, which just lets the application know that all we want to do is read from the file. We don't want to erase it. We don't want to add onto it. And because we don't know how many lines we have in our file, we would like to loop it. However, because you and I both know that our file should only have one line, the while loop is actually unnecessary. So now let's let's read from our file. So we're going to have a while loop. In this case, our file instance object data file. And we're going to use the getPosition method. In this case, because we're starting the loop, we're going to start at 0. We're also going to make sure that we are less than the total length of our file. In this case, our data file.getLength should return back to us an integer value that represents how many letters, and this includes spaces as well, there are in the file. Now, our variable nodeData is a value we're going to keep inside our while loop, so it should refresh every time we iterate through the while loop. And then we're going to convert our JSON file into a dictionary object for our variable called nodeData using the parse_json method. And inside, we're going to grab the entire line. And that's because every line in our file is basically our dictionary object. And so our dictionary object gets converted, our JSON value gets converted into a dictionary object that we pass into our node data variable. And because we're still in the while loop, we're going to take that value, our dictionary object, and we're going to grab its player name value. And the player name value should be Godot. And so Godot is going to replace the current value in our saved data dictionary object, which is Jon Snow right now. But in this line of code, it will be replaced with Godot. And we're going to do the same thing on the second line. We take our node data dictionary object that we just created from our file, and the location value should be Tron City. And we're going to replace the current value of our saved data location, which is the north. Now, when we jump up here, we're going to iterate through our while loop again. And in this case, get position should be 46. I'm not sure. It should be a value greater than the total length because we only have one line in our file, and getLine uses up the entire line. And so since we only have one file, and I believe it's like 40 letters, our getPosition should also be around 40 letters. And because 40 is not less than 40, we're going to kick out. Now, this is where things get a little tricky. And this is why I wanted the while loop, because it's a good example. Now, let's say we have more than one line, and in that one line, we have a different set of dictionary objects, or maybe just like an integer value 1 on the second line. Well, we're going to enter the while loop again, but when we reach here, notice how there's no checks for what our object is. And so it's a good idea to have an if statement here that checks if our data object is in fact a dictionary, and if in fact our dictionary happens to have a key called player name and a key called location. Now, I'm not going to show that in this episode because that's a little more advanced. I'm going to show that in the next episode when we take a look at multiple objects being saved. So for now, just keep that in mind. This load data is very basic, very amateurish, and that's because we don't have a way to make sure that the data we're grabbing is data we need, because this line of code can throw an error if something changes to our file. But nonetheless, in our example, it's not going to throw an error as long as you don't change anything. Again, I'm uploading this to GitHub. Now, once we run everything, we're going to close our file, and then we're going to exit load data. Now, when we come back to the ready virtual method, because we're running load data after we print to the screen original data, we are in fact going to show a new file. So let's go ahead and take a look at that. So when we run our game, if you look at the console log, you're going to see our original data, which is again the North and Jon Snow, and it's being replaced by Tron City and Godot. Well, that's all I have for you in this episode. Thank you so much for joining me. In the next episode, we'll be taking a look at a more advanced example of saving and loading a file in Godot. If you have any comments or questions, please feel free to leave them in the comments section down below. Thank you for subscribing, and thank you for clicking the like button. I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.